So, Kemp, it is an honor getting to speak to you, man. How are you doing today, sir?
Good man, nice to chat with you as well.
So you I don't know if you already know, but Across the Spider-Verse, probably my favorite movie of the year. Probably one of my like Into the Spider-Verse was my favorite movie beforehand, but Across the Spider-Verse happily took its place. So firstly, what was that like just joining this franchise and being able to be a part of it?
Oh, thank you for saying that. I mean the pressure was pressure we put on ourselves because understand from the very beginning when we started on this. The idea was we didn't want to just repeat what they did on the first film. Like I love the first film. I mean, I remember seeing when I first saw Into the Spider-Verse, I was actually at Pixar in production on Soul.
Oh,
So
wow.
they brought Spider-Verse to Pixar and screened it for us before it came out. And I remember kind of like leaving the theater and like calling my son, who was a teenager, and like, yo, you gotta go see this Spider-Verse movie when it comes out in the theater. So I was really, I love the first film. And when I first met Phil Lord and Chris Miller, and they kind of told me the idea of what was going to be this film, what excited me about coming on board was that it wasn't just doing what they did before, but like a little bit more. It was like, oh wow, this is a very different story. It's a very different story from like an emotional thematic point. The technology, the way the worlds that we're going to go to, it's so dramatically different that it felt like a whole new thing. It felt
Right.
as original as the first one felt, even though it was a sequel. And
Right.
a lot of that plays out in like, look at all the new characters, that we introduce. Characters like Spider-Punk, you know what I mean? Characters like Pavitra, characters like, Jess Drew Spider-Woman, or Spider-Bite. I think a lot of people would have expected to see the same, the old gang,
Yeah,
Noir
the
and Luke.
original core.
And even as we were making it, people were like, hey, where are all the old people? And it's like, no, we got these new characters and with new arcs and new stories, and it's gonna be so dope. Just trust us. But people won't trust you. So it was real, but we got to a point where, a few years into it, we started quietly showing unfinished versions to audiences, and they were getting it. You know what I mean? Like you have this period of nervousness after a couple of years because you're working in kind of a vacuum where you're building with your team, but you're in a bubble. So you're like, okay, is this going to be any good? Or are we just like kidding ourselves? So the first time you show it to an audience and it's not perfect, there's things you got to change, but you see that they get it. I was like, okay,
Right.
I think we might be onto something. You know what I mean? It was just one of those things where you just have a feeling. But the pressure was pressure we put on ourselves because this collective of artists and filmmakers who worked on this, we all have high standards. We're all trying to be original. We're all trying to make stuff that's memorable. And that was the goal with this movie.
And I mean, it was memorable. And just speaking about Spider-Punk, I know my hair's looking a little rough right now, but if y'all ever need a live action version, I'm right here. Like that I'm right
Yeah,
here for
I see, I
it.
see.
But as you were going through the story and once you saw the complete version, what was your reaction to just being a father with kids, to just seeing that relationship with Miles and his father and fully fleshing that out to where it ended at the end of this first part?
I mean, I felt proud because, to be perfectly honest, the period that Jefferson goes through with Miles in the film was really reflecting what I was going. My son's 19 now, so now
Oh,
he just
okay.
started his sophomore in college. So as I was making this, it was like COVID in the beginning. He was in high school. He was like a junior. A lot of the things that were the characters were going through, I felt like I was going through at the same time. You know what I mean? In terms of you have this kid who's like a child, then all of a sudden, just like that, they've grown 5 inches. Like my son's taller than me now. And it's just like, oh snap, like this kid is like a man, but he's still a kid to me. And they're kind of moving away from you and getting their own independence. To me, that was like so relatable. And
Right.
I love that people kind of leaned into and appreciated that relationship with between Miles and his parents and what they're dealing with, because it was literally what I was dealing with as we were, making the film. You know what I mean?
Right.
So
Yeah.
yeah, it all everything I do feels personal. You know what I mean? Like if it doesn't feel personal, I'm not really interested in doing it, and you always, I think that goes for everyone. We all try to like mine our personal experience because at the end of the day, we're not just the filmmakers, we're also the audience, and that's the kind of movie like I want to make a movie that I want to see. That's
Right.
ultimately what all I'm trying to do. Not trying to make a movie that you think people want, or don't want. We're just making something that we want to see, and that speaks to us. And I think we feel that, you know, we're representative of the world. So if we react to it, then other people are going to react to it as well.
And with this, I just feel like the Spider-Verse franchise and this one in particular as well, like every time we get a new Spider-Verse movie, it feels like it just advances animation. It just pushes it forward as a new medium. So can you just talk about what your hopes for with animation as a medium, as a storytelling? What are your hopes for the future of that as technology, as storytelling advances? What do you hope people take away from animation?
I mean, what I hope for has already happened. I mean, we're seeing it. I think the impact of Into the Spider-Verse is evident, not just on our movie, but on the entire landscape. I think people feel open to trying new things. I mean, I've enjoyed so many animated films this year. You know, I watched Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and really dug that. You know, I watched Nimona. I really dug that film. Even, you know, I worked at Pixar, but like Elemental, I really enjoyed that. Elemental, even within the Pixar form, every character is like a VFX shot. Like, I think everyone is being pushed to not just do some base house style, but like try different things. And they're realizing that all these different styles can connect in different ways. I mean, the art in animation, I think, is really starting to shine through. So the thing that I hope that it would do, I think it's kind of done it already.
Right,
you know what I mean? I haven't even seen it, but I saw like a trailer for the new Disney film Wish coming out. And I was like, is that like 2D? You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of crazy to see that, like, and I'm not saying that all of that was an impact of Into the Spider-Verse, but I know that film had an impact on me, you know? Right. And when, as we're making this film, we're kind of like, okay, we got to really, like, we don't want to just, like, even the style of Miles's world is different in Across than it was in Into the Spider-Verse. We didn't even want to just take the existing structure of a world that was done and just repeat that. We're like, no, let's rebuild Miles's world and do some different flourishes. Wow. You know what I mean? So everything with us was an evolution. And I think that animation has a limitless ability to evolve. And I think you're seeing a lot of that. You're seeing a lot of that now.
Absolutely. I got a couple more questions for you. So my first one is just, what is your particular favorite shot of the movie? I could go through a list of my favorite shots, but do you have like a specific shot that's like, that's it, that's my heart?
Yeah. Yeah. Them on when Miles and Gwen are on the clock tower, in Brooklyn, and she's sitting upside down and he's walking towards her, you know, and it's like, so she's upside down.
There's
two shots, actually. We start on her and then the camera racks up and we see Miles and then we see him walk out to the edge right before he drops down and the whole thing is inverted. Those are my two favorite shots in the entire film.
This is one of my favorite as well. And my other question for you is, with Miles, you know, he looks at Peter B as like his mentor, but he learned so much across from all these other Spider-Man. If you could go back and tell your younger self some advice or give yourself some advice, what would you tell yourself?
I would tell myself that if something that I wanted to try was scaring me, that would be a reason to know that it's the right thing to be trying. Anything worth really, you know, anytime you're trying to be original or do something different, it's kind of scary. And I think a lot of people hit that fear and they kind of run away from it. But I've found that running towards the thing that scares you a little bit usually ends up kind of being a growth opportunity. You know, even if it doesn't work, you kind of grow and you learn a few things.
And it's just my last question. I'm not going to, you know, pry you about Beyond the Spider-Verse or anything, but Spot, I feel like it was a pleasant surprise. Like, I did not expect him to go from, you know, a full-fledged villain by the end. So what do you guys plan on, like, you know, incorporating more horror elements with him? I feel like that was some of the scariest stuff in Across the Spider-Verse. Y'all plan on, like, getting more horror with his character a little bit?
Well, it's funny because like a year before the movie came out, I did an interview and said Spot's the villain in both movies and people didn't believe me. You know what I mean? They were like, that dude, they thought, oh, he's so corny. I'm like, I'm telling you, he's the villain in both movies and he evolves. And I think that, you know, you see a little taste of that evolution by the end of it. And he's a real menace. But, you know, when you talk about like such an interesting character, because when you think about Spot's powers, his powers are actually pretty incredible. And there's a lot of great characters like that in comic books where it's like, they're kind of goofy, but when you think about their powers, it's like if they applied them a certain way, it's kind of terrifying what they're capable of doing. But when it came to having a character who's like tied to Miles for one, and also is a threat to like all of reality, Spot felt like the perfect villain. So we knew where we were going with him, which was evolving him into this character that we call the Abyss. And you know, people got a little taste of it. So, you know, I think that we said that was coming a long time ago, and now I'm happy people actually believe us.
And y'all killed it. I promise this is my last question for you, but just looking past beyond the Across the Spider-Verse and beyond the Spider-Verse, what are your goals, or what are you looking to do next as far as genre, as far as like, you know, you've done live action, you've done animation. Do you have any hopes or goals that you want to knock out next in the future?
Yeah. I mean, right now there's strikes going on, so everything's kind of frozen. No one's working on anything.
Right.
But I work in different mediums. You know, I have a theater project that I'm trying to shepherd along and get made. I have a couple of live action projects that I'm trying to get along, go, you know, move along and get made. But my whole career has been about just chasing after stories that are interesting to me. And I don't really care about the genre or the medium. I just chase after what excites me. And it's worked out well for me, and I'm going to continue doing that. So, you know, I think people should prepare to be kind of be surprised, because you never know what I'm going to dive into. It's just, I'm interested in a lot of things. Let's put it that way.
Amazing. Well, I'm going to end it there. I just want to say it's an honor getting to talk to you. I cannot wait to see what you do next. Spider-Verse is out. I love those movies. I'm going to watch it again once we finish this call. But thank you again so much for giving some of your time, Kim.
No problem. Listen to the director, the filmmaker commentary, because we talk through everything while we're watching the movie. It's pretty fun.
Yes, sir. I will do. Thank you so much, man. You have a great rest of your day.
You too, man. Be safe.